Welcome to Speechless. We're live from the SEC studios in White Bear Lake, also playing live in St. Paul over SPNN. We're glad to have you here. I think we have a very interesting show. If you want to learn about family custody, family law, parenting consultants in particular, but also what's going on in the courtroom, you want to watch this show because you're going to get some really, really good insights as to what's taking place in our courtroom. And so my guest, Susan Carpenter, who is a parenting consultant, author, blogger, involved in the family law court system, helping out families, will be my guest. But before we do that, I'm going to briefly go over a Minnesota Supreme Court ruling that came out, memorandum regarding cameras in the courtroom. They've been going through testing. Actually, before I do that, this is a live call-in talk show. So if you have comments or questions, call in 651-747-3838. And if you don't want to call in, but want to leave a comment or suggestions for future shows, you can email me at speechlessmn@gmail.com. If you want to watch past shows, go to youtube.com/speechlessmn. And I appreciate all the comments. And actually, I got a comment, somebody that watches this show, I have a lot of respect for. I happen to run across them in these in my daily activities. And they said, well, Tim, your last show was just, you know, we agree on transparency. Of course, we have some different ideologies, but last week you were just too preachy. And of course, I was talking about the abortion videos that came out. And I just, and I appreciate that input. But what I told him in this situation, you know, there's a time to preach. That was a time to preach. You know, I don't want to be preachy. I want you to listen to what's going on. But absolutely, there's a time to preach. I felt that was one of them, you know. But please, I love the input. I forgot to ask them, why was I being too preachy? Why was it too preachy for you? And of course, that was kind of the setting, wasn't conducive to a discussion. But I appreciate the input, and I didn't ask the right questions when it was given. But hey, you know, that's what makes the world go around, and we wrestle together to find out solutions to hopefully make the world a better place. But when we have problems like abortion and ignore the problems that are going on, the lack of transparency, the deceitfulness, and that's not being exposed, and we're not, and it's finally being exposed, and there's pushback to it being exposed, that's a problem. And those are times not to back down. And, you know, a good preaching is needed once in a while. So anyway, I always appreciate the comments and suggestions. And some are helpful, some are not. And some of the things I say are helpful, and some of the things I say aren't. So anyway, so let's get to this cameras in the courtroom issue, because it's an issue I've been dealing with. I've wanted to film in district court, especially criminal trials, because it's just fascinating what goes on. And when you hear the testimony of our public officials, you're going, wow, I can't believe I just heard that. Do they really believe that? And you get to see how they really are and how they really think. And one of the places I wanted to film was the Michelle McDonald, who was running for the Minnesota Supreme Court. I wanted to film her trial on DWI, and driving under the influence, DUI. And because there's the testimony of these police officers that was fascinating. Why they did what they did, they're admitting that they lied, they're admitting that she wasn't under arrest, but they told her she was under arrest anyway to try to get her out of the car. No, she didn't need to come out of the car, but since she wasn't coming, we lied to her, said she was under arrest, and then since she didn't get out of the car, and even though she knew she didn't have to get out of the car, we took her out of the car anyway because she was resisting an order that was unlawful. So all that's being appealed. She was found not guilty on the DUI. But you need to hear this and to hear what our government is doing. And when officials misbehave, you need to hear it and see it. But our courts don't want that to be seen, in my opinion. And they cover it with a fair trial issue. If there's a camera in the courtroom, we can't have a fair trial, or it will greatly decrease the chances of having a fair trial. My answer to that is, because the Constitution guarantees freedom of the press, we get to be there. Because the Constitution guarantees a fair trial, that means the press, the media, being in the courtroom, being allowed to film, is the guarantee of a fair trial. If you can't have the press there, you don't have a fair trial. And that includes recorded video. And actually, that would be a could be a defense lawyer's way to appeal. I didn't have a fair trial because the cameras weren't allowed and people couldn't see what was going on in the courtroom. And the public wasn't allowed to the fullest extent practicable to be able to see the trial. And I mean, that's an angle I would use. But what the court is saying, the possibility of not having a fair trial by the cameras being there and people acting up or people behaving a different way because the cameras are there could lead to a mistrial. Well, it's something that hasn't happened in all the states that have had cameras in the courtroom. It hasn't happened. And if a person grandstands in front of the camera, first of all, the cameras, you hardly notice them. I mean, you can tell they're there, but these attorneys and these judges, once they're engaged in the process, they're focused on their clients, they're focused on their case. They don't notice the camera. And it's such a case where I've been in the appellate court filming, and they say, well, you know, if you're the one filming, you got to come in before the first hearing and you got to stay for the other three hearings because we don't want a disruption in the courtroom with you tearing your equipment down and leaving. And I tell them, look, I'll have that camera out of that courtroom and all my gear out of the courtroom faster than the attorneys can get out of the courtroom from the case we just watched. And then they were able to see that because they let me do it, because I asked. And they let me do it, otherwise hanging around for another 2 hours doing nothing. And so I did it, unplugged the camera, picked up the tripod, walked out. The attorneys haven't even left the front bench. So the other group hadn't even gotten up. So there's these misconceptions of what they have, and I think they also have an intentional misconception of what the cameras do in order to accomplish their political agenda. Let's go with the phone call we have here first, and then I will get into what their new rules are. So, caller, do you have a comment or a question?
Tim Kinley.
Hey.
Good show tonight.
Thank you.
Hey, the question is, what do you make about this thing they were playing all over the commercial news, local news, this deal about the Donovan Frank? Donovan Frank, he's the federal judge. Called in to do negotiation on apparently something that's going to cost $20 million to $100 million. He brought in the governor.
Right.
He brought in the Republican leader. He brought in the Democratic leader.
Right.
And the news media, they filed motions against the judge, against federal judge Donovan Frank.
For what?
For having this closed meeting.
Closed meeting.
And I never understood that because there's all kinds of closed meetings in the court system. There's a lot of non-transparency. That's the status quo. That's the rules they play by. Where there's supposed to be open meetings is in the government, the state house, the state senate. And what puzzles me, and I can't solve that problem, is, okay, the governor goes because he does all the stuff in back rooms. But the Speaker of the House and the Majority Leader, they're supposed to conduct themselves in the sunlight. And so why are they going to this meeting if
right.
I think the complaint is more about the Minnesota House and the Minnesota Senate than the court system, because the House and Senate could open up the court system, and the Congress could open up the federal courts if they want to. They don't want to.
They're
against it.
There's your very good point. Here's the point here. This is a jurisdictional issue. Okay, Donovan Frank did not have a court hearing. He said, I'm getting you guys together, and we're going to have a discussion. They, at that point in time, said, no, Donovan Frank, you're out of your jurisdiction. This is our state issue. We will have an open meeting in the legislature, and you can come, and we'll let you talk and testify, okay? But you don't bring us into your jurisdiction without motions filed, without a question being raised. You're not here the
That's
one negotiating.
Huh? And of course, my point is, two points. Number one, first of all, why did they show up? I mean, why even show up?
Exactly.
That seems bizarre.
Right.
That they should, that seems very odd. The second thing is, why is the Star Tribune and CBS or WCCO filing all these motions with the court to open it up and complaining about the federal court system when their real issue is they should be complaining about the Minnesota House and the Minnesota Senate? I think the lawyers over there and the executives over at the Star Tribune, they didn't explain why they're picking on the federal court system and not on the Minnesota government.
Well, I personally think it's a both and. They should pick on the federal system. First of all, I think Donovan Frank's ruling was correct. It's unconstitutional to add all these charges up once you've been convicted and then add more afterwards. It's basically a piling on. It's double jeopardy. And then the other, and then it should go after the legislature for showing up. And the legislature could have just said, no, Donovan Frank, you don't have jurisdiction. We'll have a hearing. You can come. The press will be there. We'll let you have your say. And then see what would have happened. And if Donovan Frank said, okay, you haven't come to my courtroom, I'm going to fine you, the state could have said, you know what, Donovan Frank, too bad. Where are you going to get the money from? And that would have been Governor Dayton saying, no, it's not going to happen. So they could have had that battle, should have had that battle. But the legislature needs to work that issue out with sexual predators and deal justly with it. And they're not, and they haven't. So it's a free-for-all is what it ends up being. All right, good call, good question. So, of course, that gets into the cameras in the courtroom again issue. You can't have a camera in federal district court. You can't have camera in federal appellate court, although some places around the country do have a trial period, a testing time in the appellate courts. And then the Supreme Court doesn't have cameras, U.S. Supreme Court. It just baffles me. But here's what the Minnesota Supreme Court said, except for Alan Page. And this is the one issue. I think Alan Page has been very fair on family law issues over his career. But on this one, I just think he just doesn't get it. So here's what the Minnesota Supreme Court, after careful and thorough review of the committee's recommendation, a committee to what should we do with these cameras, the written comments and public hearing comments, this court authorized a limited pilot project as follows. Except as limited below, electronic coverage shall be permitted at proceedings held in the courtroom in the presence of the presiding judge after a guilty verdict has been returned or a guilty plea has been accepted, provided adequate advance notice of the intended coverage is given as directed by the trial court. So in other words, you don't get to film during the trial except for the guilty plea after it's been accepted and after the guilty verdict has been returned. So, that's permitted. You get to hear the guilty verdict and you get to hear a guilty plea. Provided adequate notice, and of course you never know when a person's going to plead guilty and it's being accepted. Yeah, that happens, that can happen really, really quick. And then, so you'd have to give notice just at the beginning of the trial and say, we want to film whenever the court, under the rules, if these things are going to happen, we want to be there to film it. And then pretty much you're going to have to be there within an hour, half hour, whatever, So, but regardless of the consent of parties, no electronic coverage is permitted of any proceeding held with a jury present. So jury trials, criminal jury trials, you don't get to film there. So it'd have to be a trial just in front of a judge. No coverage is permitted in any proceeding held in Minnesota's problem-solving courts, including drug courts, mental health, veterans court, and DWI courts. I think that's exactly where the camera should be. I don't see any problem with them being there. Somebody can come up with one, but I'd like to have that discussion. Why would that be a problem? No coverage is permitted in cases involving crimes of criminal sexual conduct or family or domestic violence. Personally think there should be cameras there too. No coverage of any testifying victim is permitted unless that victim before testifying affirmatively acknowledges and agrees in writing to the proposed coverage. Well, we don't know if a person's a victim until afterwards, after the hearing. They may be a false accuser. Those are just things we don't know, and therefore we don't get to see the hearing or understand the particulars of the case. In all other circumstances, the presiding judge may limit or exclude media requests for electronic courtroom coverage based on the interests and safety concerns of the participants to the proceedings, the decorum and dignity of the proceedings, and the impartial administration of justice, which basically means a judge can stop you for any reason they want. So, anything changed? Not really. So, anyway, we got another call here. Caller, you got a comment or a question?
Oh, I have a comment.
Okay, hey.
I agree with you. It is, it was on the front page of both the Pioneer Press and the Star Tribune. The media's getting access to the courts. How hogwash, how folly, how boulderdash.
Right.
This is Rich Neumeister.
So, hey, Rich. Good to see you.
So, let's say what it really is. I mean, this has been an ongoing thing for almost a decade now. A little bit of this, a little bit of that, and a little bit of civil. How much civil? And you're right. I mean, like I did on social media today, I said, "Oh wow, criminal sentencing," but there are so many vetoes or whatever. It really doesn't get to the 21st century of actual transparency.
Right.
And I view this just as like I said, I was the person that made the comment about preachiness.
Sure.
So if I have no problem with self-identifying myself, because I've always said, we agree on some things, we disagree on others.
Right.
But the whole issue of transparency in the courts is not just this, but it's also on how, if you want to look at documents, you want to take, document copies home, where they charge you $10, $15 for even one page. That's not transparency.
No.
And as you know, where I met you was at a law library.
Right.
Where I was looking for a brief.
Right.
Couldn't get it, could you? The only place where I can look at the brief, because it's now online, is at the law library.
Right.
I don't think I could, go across the courthouse to a local courthouse and look at it. It seems like it's only at the library.
Right.
So for me, the whole issue is the courts need to get out of the mid-1940s kind of thinking and get into 2015. And the inertia is not there.
No.
And that's what, there were legislators in the past who tried to do some things. Like I remember Representative Howard Ornstein.
Mm-hmm.
And as you know, there are many agencies under the judicial branch. One of them is the Lawyers Responsibility Board.
Right.
And how they keep a lot of things like complaints against lawyers. You don't even know how many complaints have ever been against lawyers. But for public employees, you do.
Right.
And so the thing was, he tried to open that up. But
same with judges, you don't know.
That's correct. I mean, you know, and all I'm saying is the mentality has to change. And the other point that you bring up, the legislature has to have the guts to start passing some laws to sort of say, yes, you're going to have the courts are going to be open. Yes, this. I mean, the Supreme Court, you know, they're afraid that Congress is going to pass a law, you know, that says that they're going to, you know, pass a law that you're going to have cameras in and all that. And they have hearings on that all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And the Minnesota legislature should be having that.
Right. But like you said, that legislature is afraid of the courts.
I don't know.
They are afraid of the courts. I mean, I've talked to the legislators. They're afraid.
It depends on who is chair.
Well, but then it's just one person.
Well, but the chair can hold a hearing, and there will probably be other people who would follow him or her.
Right.
So
it would take some leadership, but it also takes a public outcry. And that's, even though there's an outcry, it's got to be more than just a handful of people.
Well, all I know is that sometimes a handful of people have made a difference at the legislature.
Exactly.
And being there for over, tongue-in-cheek say, just only there 2 years. No, seriously. As you know, I've been over there for a long time.
Yeah.
As a citizen and person who lobbies. And a handful of people and a couple of people can make a difference over there.
Yeah, you're exactly right.
So, anyways, I just wanted to make the comment about you're getting into the, agree with you, to me, it's just pure folly and just pure words, and now we're going to wait till 2018 to see if anything happens again. That's 3 years from now.
Right. They
don't want to bite the bullet.
And this is where, if somebody wants to fund a lawsuit, we can get a lawsuit going any day, because I get denied all the time. Anytime I put in a request to film a jury trial, I get denied. You know, so we can do this at any time, but I can't fund it.
Right. Well, anyway, thank you for the few moments of your time.
All right. Thank you for your time. Always appreciate your comments and your work. He's done a fantastic job of having open government, and so really appreciate what he's done down there. All right. I spent a lot more time on that than I thought I would. Appreciate the callers calling in. So I have my guest, Susan Carpenter, here. We're finally going to get to you. So now we got to speed up our conversation.
Right.
Because we know this can, well, you know what? I'm just going to have you back again, you know.
Sounds good.
But let's give your history here. You're a parenting consultant. That's one of the things you do.
One of the things. I'm a reluctant parenting consultant.
Okay.
But my history is that I entered into the family law system back in 1998, and I went through 8 years of just in and out of court all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Finally, you know, tried to figure out how to get this wrapped up, because nobody should be in court that long. And we just, it worked out. I had a lot of things go my way, you know, but it shouldn't take somebody 8 years to navigate this system. You look to the professionals in the system to lead you, you know, and that doesn't happen. So after that experience, I've actually been through 2 custody battles. I won the big one. And then later, my youngest child, when they were 17, I lost custody in a very quick 10-minute thing.
Really? 10
with
minutes?
No evidence, nothing going on. But, you know, some of that was because of his age and things like that. So, and everything worked out fine. Afterwards, you know, my kids and I are closer than ever. They're close to their dad now, too. You know, they just know who we both are.
Right.
And have,
sure.
We have those relationships
right.
based on who each of us is. So I went through that, after that experience, I wanted to help people because I had all this knowledge. I mean, you know how that is.
Yes.
You learn things as you go.
Right.
And I thought, what do I do? Should I be an attorney? No, I don't think I can stand that. Mm-hmm. And I thought, you know, maybe I'll be a psychologist. So I went and got a bachelor's degree in psychology. I was going to go on, get a master's or a PhD and become a licensed therapist and help in that way. But then I got into mediation in between. I just kind of fell into mediation and started doing some other things here and there and just helped educate people about the processes,
right.
How to best make yourself look at your best. I mean, it's a horrible thing. These are family issues. It's stressful. It's hurtful, you know, it's a very difficult thing to go through. And so when people are uncertain and they're stressed out, they don't appear their best. And so that can really hurt them in court. I help people focus on what you can change, you know, what's in your control, what's not. I don't do anything about law. I'm not a lawyer. I'm not practicing law, anything like that. I help them work with their lawyers a little better, asserting themselves, things like that. And just understanding, complaining about things without some kind of action happening too is going to get you nowhere. That's how you end up in here for 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 years.
And it's how you go crazy as an individual
in
managing the system. Action has to be taken.
Right.
And it has to be done in the right way.
Exactly. And so I try to help people. There are some professionals that we know historically are not going to help. You know, you don't want to be with certain people in this system if you can avoid it. So I help people there. And then I've just kind of, a lot of things have happened. I've been writing. I have an interest in politics, too. I'm pretty well informed there. And so that's what's happening to me right now, is there's a little political stuff going on. I you know, do family law things where I'm trying to actually help families, and especially the kids. And then I got involved. I knew Michelle McDonald.
Okay, who ran for the Minnesota Supreme Court.
I'd met her. Well, our history is actually very interesting. Michelle, at one time, not during any of the custody trials, but at one time Michelle was my ex-husband's attorney.
Oh, really?
Okay. And I couldn't stand her. And she thought I was a psychopath. So we do kind of laugh because, you know, I found out about Family Innocence. And
which is an organization that Michelle
that she has. Yes. And so I, at the same time, I've been trying to bring a high conflict divorce program, education program here to Minnesota.
Okay.
It's been very difficult. People don't want to, you know, they have their special players in the system that get their things put in. So I was trying to do that. And her and I actually did we did these ads in City Pages, and her ad was like, either right above mine or kitty corner from mine.
Oh, really?
And so I saw that and I'm like, Michelle McDonald, really? You know, I didn't believe it. And so I dismissed it at first because, you know, I didn't care for her. And then I learned that, no, she's really doing this and she really is trying to show the problems. And that was the same thing I was trying to do. Mm-hmm. So I connected with her. Mm-hmm. And we went from there. But I knew her on a professional level, so we didn't talk politics at all. And I found out the day before she was going for the endorsement with the GOP.
Oh, okay.
And I had no idea. So got a little bit involved in that. We all know how that went.
Right.
You know, so now I've been writing, and I've teamed up with some people. We've decided that we want to be like a news and information source. That's what we're trying to get to. We're kind of new. So far, I'm the only one who's been writing. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to get other people to write. But I have some experience and have been writing things, putting them out there for a while. It takes practice.
Yeah, well, I've met you at a number of events, family law events, court hearing, and court hearings and the legislature. And then I started reading some of your blogs. Now, one, well, what's the name of your mediation group? Or you have a website?
I'm Life's Doors Mediation.
Life's mm-hmm. Doors Mediation. Okay.
I do mediation.
Let's put up the web page here just so people can see that it exists.
Okay. I do mediation. I do conflict coaching with people. And I do parenting consultant, parenting time expediter things, uh-huh. even though I'm someone kind of opposed yeah. to those processes.
Can we get the web page up? Story. Can you switch to the computer here? So, yeah, so this is the web page, Life Door Mediation.
Yeah, and I've done some blogging, you know.
Well, you've written a book, too.
I wrote a book about parenting consultants. That was
right.
the problem in my case, why it dragged on for 8 years.
Uh-huh.
Having this person not, you know, they keep you out of court, which can be a very good thing.
Uh-huh.
If they're doing something,
right.
you know.
But there's times you have to go to court.
Absolutely. Yes.
And you just need to get things, okay, attorneys, quit yapping and raising the fees.
Right.
Let's get this into court. This isn't that difficult. Let's get this done.
Right. And then, you know, with high conflict, you go through this and you're trying to get out of it
uh-huh.
so that you can move forward with your life and
uh-huh.
your kids and whatever the new life is now going forward for the whole family.
Right.
So the frustration builds when you're trying to just move on and you're stuck here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and sometimes parenting consultants, boy, that camera is really bright. Turn down the white balance there. Anyway, some parenting consultants can really mess you up, too.
Yes, they really can.
I mean, real bad, because they have a bias
yeah.
towards a particular sex versus one sex versus the other.
Right.
Father
and
can't be a good father, or mother can't be a good mother.
Right.
Yeah, it's really bad.
And then they're not really, I mean, they're immune from anything, and
mm-hmm.
they're not lawyers, really. So they get into your life, and they're telling you about your day-to-day life and putting out orders to order you to do this and that and the other thing, where they really don't have any business doing that. They're supposed to resolve disputes, but
mm-hmm.
some of them are big meddlers who, if there's not a problem, they sometimes make problems.
Well, why? And why would that be? Why would they make a problem when there's not a problem? In that type
Money.
Of situation, yeah.
Yeah.
I need a conflict in order to be paid.
Right.
I don't have my calendar full for this week.
Well, and there's another thing, too. Their role is to keep you out of court now.
Mm-hmm.
You've been in court way too many times.
Mm-hmm.
Judges are sick of you, quite frankly. And so they're going to take you and try to fix you.
Right.
You know, keep
right.
them out of court. So if they fail at that and you
mm-hmm.
end up in court, you know, they don't want to be seen as bad, then they won't get assigned anymore. So, again,
mm-hmm.
it all comes to money.
Yeah.
You know.
And so I was reading, and I've been following this Michelle McDonald case, the Sandra Grazzini-Recchi case.
Yes.
And then you started blogging on that. And so you've created this blog place.
Yeah.
Red Herring a lot. Red Herring Alert. WordPress.com. And we got that. So if you can show that up here. This is your blog
and you're,
page.
And you're familiar with the term red herring, right?
Well, yeah, I am.
okay.
So my understanding is some press people like Michael Broadcore and Brandon Stahl, Star Tribune writers,
right.
were discussing the McDonald endorsement to the Supreme Court and the Sandra Grazzini-Recchi case.
Right.
And then you... started blogging in response to that.
I
did. Is that correct?
Yes, okay. It is. And some of it is, you know, the timing is so interesting on how this all went down.
Right.
And I actually have something here, I think, with that. I know Michelle, first she applied to the Supreme Court, and I think that was April 13th. Or they reposted an article that day, that might be. But she applied for the opening coming up on the Minnesota Supreme Court.
Right, and that was after the election.
Yes.
Yes.
And she also applied for the opening, she filed her civil rights lawsuit against Dakota County officials.
Okay.
That was April 13th.
Okay.
When Broadcorp posted the article about that, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
So then, within 10 days, it was about 10 days later, then here starts coming these articles about Grazini Rucki and Michelle McDonald's wrongdoing, and these girls are missing, and mm-hmm. laws are being violated, and mm-hmm. calling for a grand jury investigation.
Right.
You know, so to me, that was obvious, and I know there are even people I disagree politically with who were putting these things on Facebook and saying, well, you know, that seems, I'm suspicious of the timing. So
right.
that was one of the first things. And then, you know, they're talking points. There's a lot of missing information, and people are pretending they don't know what the case is really about.
Well,
and that's impossible.
There you go. And of course, there's the red herring.
Exactly.
We don't know these
no
things
idea.
When they do know, so they're taking you down a trail that isn't an accurate trail.
Right.
And one of the issues that is not being discussed in these articles, and I've read most of them, including yours, but you're discussing it, and I think you hit it right on the head. What about these judges?
Right.
Why are these judges not being questioned about their behavior and their culpability in where these children are?
Exactly.
You know?
Yep. Who's in charge of this process, you know?
Right. Yeah, so when Judge David Knudsen, well, let's talk about one of these. One of these issues was, first of all, Judge Warminger had the first part of the Sandra Grazini lawsuit, right?
Right.
And there was a divorce. I don't like divorce, but there's a divorce going
right.
on. And the divorce papers were signed, notarized, you know, and came before Judge Warminger. The father, husband didn't show up, said he wasn't going to be there. I think at that point, Judge Warminger should have gone and said, you know what, we're going to set another day, make sure he's here. But he didn't do that.
Right.
But the law says he doesn't have to.
Exactly.
Okay. And if you got a paper in front of you that's signed and notarized and you got a notary there, you know, he can go with it. I wouldn't do that, personally. If I were a judge, I would say, no, that person's got to
right.
be here.
It seems suspicious if somebody wouldn't be there.
If they wouldn't be there for, like, the third time,
mm-hmm.
and you know that that person was properly noticed, you know, I would say, okay.
Right.
You know, but, so I think that's the first mistake in all of this. So Sandra actually divided it up as normal divorces are divided up, from what I could read.
It looks fairly
fair property
split
division.
To me.
Yeah, I didn't see anything wrong with it. I wouldn't have liked it as a father, just in the fact that I didn't have joint custody.
Right.
Okay,
yeah.
And that's normal, not having a joint custody. It
can be. I mean, you know, it all depends. It depends on what works for the family.
Right, right.
They can agree to whatever they want to.
Right, they can.
Yep.
And that's what it looked like on paper. But then Judge David Knudsen coming into the play and the father reopening the case saying he's defrauded, that just added a whole nother dimension to this case. And Judge Knudsen's behavior in this case,
was it Knudsen? I don't remember
David Knudsen
reopening or...
That's my understanding.
Okay.
Yeah, he reopened it, and he's the one that said, yeah, there was fraud in this case. He didn't have to go there. He didn't have to be this harsh. But that may have been the only solution that was left to him.
Right.
Yeah.
And what I did read about that is they thought something fishy was going on. They actually used that term.
Right, yes. But that doesn't mean fraud took place.
Exactly.
And so now this guy's coming back saying, this father, I want my day in court. If his scenario was the way he described it, I'd want my day in court too.
Right.
And but then for David Knutson to just totally defraud both of them in a real large sense with denying all their kids to either of them.
Oh yeah, it got
it
out of hand.
Way over the top. Didn't need to go there, and that's on him. That's where I saw was that's just on David Knutson, and you called that out too.
Right. Neither one of them had custody at the time when they had the actual trial. The kids were already, two of the kids are missing. So I mean, that who's the judge here? Who's in charge? Who should be moving this thing along? And
right.
And looking at evidence to see who's proving their case.
Well, and this is where a psychologist and a parenting consultant came in. There
was
an
guardian.
A guardian.
Carrie, yeah.
Okay, had an emergency hearing, and the attorneys were on the phone, but the clients weren't.
Right.
Which is really bizarre for an emergency hearing. And was it the psychologist? I forget his name.
There, Dr. Paul Reitman.
Reitman, right. Yep. He went and only met with the mother for half an hour with Sandra Grazini.
Yes, it was one meeting is what I understand. And it does say in Knutson's order that only 4 of the 5 children were even there.
Oh, okay.
It actually says that in there. So not even one of the kids wasn't even there. And apparently we're going to decide custody based on that, or we're going to decide to take kids away from both parents based on that.
Half-hour meeting.
Yeah.
And the attorneys were not able to cross-examine the psychologist.
Right.
Or the parenting consultant. It's just bizarre. And then you lose your kids.
It is. And that's one of the things with family court. As you go along, you're guilty before you have an opportunity to even present your evidence a lot of times.
Right. So this emergency, I mean, I don't understand the parameter of this emergency hearing because there was no physical threat.
Right.
Well, wait, there wasn't there? It was actually the father who had called in and on a recorded message.
Well, that, I believe that was much earlier, if I recall.
It was earlier, yeah.
So why wasn't there an emergency hearing at that point?
Back then.
Right.
Yeah, so there's no physical threat now. Right, exactly. And this is part of, I'm little sarcasm there, but I'm not being sarcastic because why didn't that constitute an emergency? Why didn't the domestic violence industry, as I call it, come around and say what's going
right,
on here?
Right.
This was definitely, if they can prove that the phone call exists, that it was actually him, and why wasn't this a terroristic threat? Why wasn't there restraining orders put out? Oh, they were asked for, but they were denied. So.
Yeah, it's. It's craziness. You get into, with domestic violence especially, you are really caught between systems because it should be a crime, but we're just going to let family law pick up. Family law is a catch-all
mm-hmm.
for anything. If you get in family law, that's where you have to go to resolve everything. And it a lot of things don't fit in there. They don't know what they're doing in there.
Well, and that brings up a point in our prior discussion that you were talking about, is it really family law? Is it criminal? So when you're denied parenting time, it's a criminal
right.
statute, right?
It is a criminal statute, 609.26.
Okay, and you go report that to police, and the police will say, and I've done this to the Maplewood Police, they will say, and the Ramsey County Sheriffs, and Oakdale, and, oh, it's a civil matter.
Right, it's a domestic, is usually what they say.
Yeah.
And what they mean by that is family law is domestic relations law.
Right.
And that's really messed up a lot of things that we get into relationships, basically.
Yeah, but the law on that issue of denial of parenting time is really, really clear.
It is.
It's very well written, and it's very clear. And the answer they'll give, well, it's just too bad. We're not going to do any.
Yep.
Take it before a judge.
So that's been one of my questions, too, like Michael Broadcorb, Ron Rosenbaum, people like that, Brandon Stahl. I don't know if he's said that, but they would like, you know, Sandra and Michelle to be in front of a grand jury. They would like, this is what I get out of reading their things, is they want someone to go after Michelle and Sandra on 609.26.
Mm-hmm.
Which, that's where I started saying, okay, but any other time, nobody bothers with that. Very rarely.
Well, and here's the retort I got back when reporting and talking to the Ramsey County attorney. When I reported my parenting time being denied, it says, well, there's three exclusions. There's three reasons you can deny parenting time. You feel that your children are at threat. A feeling, you know.
Right.
And so these people, well, like Ron Rosenbaum or Michael Broadcore, mm-hmm. or even maybe even David Timmer, that's his name?
Steve Timmer.
Yeah. That's a justifiable defense. So a grand jury's not going to, they're going to hear, well, boy, here's these gunshots. Here you got two kids. And actually a number of kids that went into a private meeting with the judge, told the judge of the gunshots, and the judge says, no, you got to see your dad, just blowing them away.
Right.
You know, so the two girls run.
And that's another interesting thing, too, is because these aren't little children, you know, mm-hmm. these are children who should have some kind of a voice. You know, I mm-hmm. guess you could say the guardian is speaking for them.
But if the guardian's not listening.
Exactly. And if they're terrified for
right.
whatever reason, what is the court's angle in mm-hmm. we're going to make you go?
Right.
That's what I don't understand. Mm-hmm. What's in it for you, you know, Judge Knutson, that these girls must go there? They could, at this point, you know, be cautious and let's get to the bottom of things.
Mm-hmm.
Let's really get to the bottom of things. But they just make decisions based on feelings a lot
right.
of times in family court.
Yeah.
But are we a court of law or are we a court of feelings?
Well, we'll leave that up to, I know I have my opinion on that.
Yeah.
Oh boy, my time's going fast here. So I think, you know, the other thing that's happening is parents going through a divorce, things escalate. And a judge has to sift through that
right.
and be able to tell these people, look, let's take a deep breath. I'm not going to hurt anybody. You know, I'm not going to destroy your lives. In reality, the shadow of the law that's out there, there is a destruction that happens over and over somebody's life.
Right.
And it doesn't need to take place. And so that fear is there, not only losing the kids, having your life destroyed. So that, do you see that heightening the parents' reactions in these things, that they then go do things they wouldn't normally do?
Yes, all the time. And I've talked to many, many parents, and my case was like this too. We actually had an agreement on most things. We had an agreement on custody, child support, the bills, the house. There would have been a few things we're missing, you know, but you kind of have an idea when you decide to divorce, what that you're not going to share everything now.
Right.
We're not going to continue living
right.
here, and some things have to change. And so we made some decisions. I've heard this from many high conflict people. They actually had an agreement. Then they get into court and they're told, oh, you can't do that. It has to be this. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and they get
led. Or an attorney will say, look, you get this automatically. So why are you giving that up?
Right. Or you can get more.
Or you can get more.
You know, so don't give that, you know,
right
now. We're going to strategize. So it goes awry depending on who the person is you're working with who's helping you. If they want to drag your case out or if your lawyer's talking you into what they think you should have, or if you're, you know, this is what I want, this is all I need, you know. There's a lot of things that play into it, you know. And history of the couple is a big piece of that, too.
Mm-hmm.
So it really depends on who is in there. If you understand what's happening, that's mm-hmm. another thing. Family court, a lot of people don't understand what's happening, and you think it should go a certain way.
Right.
You think, well, this is the law. And so that's what's going to happen. Or, you know, there's justice there, or the person telling the truth wins, and you go in there and things happen. You haven't even had a chance to speak and tell your story.
Right.
Or they ignored everything you put forth. I've seen where people put forth, you know, their evidence. The other side may not even have any. But it's still ruled against the person
mm-hmm.
who presented things because
mm-hmm.
nobody read them or cared, you
or
know,
cared.
Didn't find it pertinent. So.
Yeah. This happened in the Grazini-Rucki case where the children were brought into the judge to have a private conversation
right.
by themselves. I just find that appalling. Without the attorneys there, without somebody representing the kids, and then they seal the record. And
yes.
the judge makes his decisions based off of what the kids say.
Right.
I can't imagine for my life that the courts actually think that's sane. You know,
right.
because you can't.
Especially with, you've got two people now who this case has gone on for a while. So you have two parents who really don't trust each other.
Mm-hmm.
And they've both learned not to trust the system, too.
Uh-huh.
Who's going to believe what the kids said? Or, you know, there's just no way. That's not a good way to do this.
And as attorneys, you don't know where to go from there.
Right.
How do you defend your client? You can't. You don't know what the children said. The judge is always going to, and the judge will always hold that over.
Yeah.
I know what the kids said. Well, what'd they say?
Right.
I can't tell you.
Yeah.
You know, well, they may have been on your side, but the judge doesn't like you. You know, who
knows?
And it's just a total lack of transparency there. Okay, we got
right.
just a couple minutes left.
Okay.
The last thing I want to talk about here is kind of how Michelle McDonald has been attacked in this situation. You know, not only from the press or from the courts. You know,
right.
in this. So what's kind of your perspective? Because she's been getting beat up pretty
yeah.
good.
Well, I know she did tell me one time that she didn't even believe Sandra when she came to her. Now,
mm-hmm.
Michelle got involved after Sandra was removed from her home. We haven't even talked about that.
Right, yeah.
But she was removed from her home, given an hour and a half notice, which is ridiculous. Removed
Terrible.
From her home, all of her property, except for one suitcase
mm-hmm.
of clothing.
And no criminal trial.
Right.
Nothing.
Right. No yeah. process to do that, you know, depending on eviction or other procedures.
So this
you
was
would
a hearing that
days.
Lasted half an hour? With this emergency hearing,
yeah.
and Sandra's attorney actually didn't even defend her.
Right. Yeah, that's
I mean, didn't couldn't cross-examine the...
And that was not Michelle McDonald.
That was not Michelle, no.
I just want to clarify.
And so, boy, that's a whole other issue because these attorneys have charged Sandra hundreds of thousands of dollars, one I think around 80, another around 200,000. And what did she get for it? No representation, very little.
Right.
And so Michelle asked for an accounting. What did you do?
Yeah.
And because she asked according to the law, the process, the judge said that's too harsh. And because you asked these attorneys to do this accounting, and you should have asked them nicely instead of with a subpoena, which you're supposed to subpoena.
Right.
We're fining you, and you got to pay all the attorney's costs for defending themselves. Unbelievable.
Right.
I mean,
that, you know, you would think that in our system of justice that we want it to actually serve the people who are using it,
right,
which is the consumers. But that's a whole nother issue. You know, it's the professionals. This is their, I don't know, it's a system that polices itself.
Mm-hmm.
And if you get the right people, things might work out for you, but that's pretty rare.
Yeah. Oh, we're out of time already. I can hear the music. I'm going to have you on again, and then we can be...
Right,
we kind of did the broad picture, but there's so many specific things here that are just so wrong in this case. But we kind of laid out the groundwork for it.
Yes, I think so.
All right, thanks for coming on, Susan. I appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
All right. Hey, remember, if you don't stand up for other people's liberties, who's going to stand up for yours? And good men don't do nothing. God bless. Have a great week. We'll see you next week at 8 o'clock. All right, bye. You see that you're long gone. The days go by, the forest sets on fire.